Upfront Books presents A History of Japan, From Stone Age to Superpower, written by Kenneth G. Henshall and narrated by Stephen Bungay. Preface. Aims and Sources. The main aim of this book is to tell the story of Japan. The story needs to be told from the beginning. It needs to be told in a balanced and comprehensive way, but without becoming cluttered, and in a way that makes Japan's history accessible and understandable without becoming simplistic or superficial. Many books on Japan's history are encyclopedic in nature and have so much detail it becomes difficult to see overall trends. Others tend to focus narrowly on a theme and omit background important for a balanced perspective. Still others tend to start Japan's story in modern times, omitting important earlier background. Such books all have their merits, but they do tend to daunt the non-specialist. In this day and age when so many people are interested in Japan, and particularly its rise to superpower status, this seems a pity. General readers, students, and scholars in other specialist fields should all have easier access to Japan's fascinating and instructive history. Accessibility, therefore, has been a major consideration in the writing of this book. A related consideration has been to encourage listeners to follow up particular points of interest to them. For these reasons, I have deliberately confined my sources to those in the English language, and I have deliberately and very frequently given references with a view to listeners following these up if they wish. They will not have to read Japanese to do so. My own knowledge of Japan's history has been built up over many years from both Japanese and English sources. But not everyone can afford to spend 10 years or so learning to read Japanese. When I started studying Japanese some 30 years ago, an inability to read the script was a major barrier to acquiring any sort of authoritative knowledge of the country. This is no longer so. Nowadays, there is a vast amount of material available in English, not only works written originally in English, but translations of just about every major Japanese work. As a result, it is perfectly possible for the English language reader to gain a very informed understanding, even of detailed matters about Japan. Part of my aim in this book is to draw the attention of a wider public to this wealth of available material. In fact, there is so much available that I simply cannot touch upon all of it. Japan's story is a fascinating one. It has elements of adventure, of mystery and intrigue, and of controversy, and I include these in the story within this book. It is important for everyone, even if they are not academics, to know what areas and events in Japan's history are still unclear and uncertain. Many listeners will be particularly interested in how Japan became a superpower. Japan's achievements are the result of both circumstance itself and Japan's response to circumstance, a response pattern often based on deep-rooted values and practices. I do not let these values and practices dominate my account of Japan's history, but I do highlight them and list them in the review at the end of each part, as well as writing my conclusion around them. The periodic reviews are intended to help accessibility. Japan's history is so long and rich that it is important to stop from time to time and look back, to try to pick out major trends and events. The more we can digest of Japan's history, the greater our reward, for it is a history well worth knowing. Preface, 2/3 edition. Subsequent to the appearance of the second edition in 2004, there have been a number of new developments in Japan, together with new scholarship related to events in its earlier history. Recent developments include official recognition in 2008 of the Ainu as indigenous people, the toppling of the Liberal Democratic Party, LDP, in 2009 by the Democratic Party of Japan, DPJ, the recovery of the economy, despite a setback in the world recession of 2008-09, and a substantial amount of public debt, the rapid, indeed annual, turnover of prime ministers, with there being 6 incumbents to October 2011 since Koizumi resigned in September 2006, the controversial deployment of Self-Defense Force personnel to Somalia in 2009, and, of course, the enormous catastrophe of 11 March 2011 in the form of the Tohoku earthquake and tsunami, compounded by leakage of radioactive material from damaged nuclear reactors. Recent scholarship has also revealed new information about earlier events. For example, genetic research has cast interesting light on the origins of the Japanese. More details are emerging about links between Korea and early Japan. Marine archaeology has literally uncovered a major factor in the destruction of Kublai Khan's invasion fleet of 1281. There has been more evidence to suggest that the famed samurai were not actually characterized by fighting to the death, and so on. Structurally, I have expanded the last section of Part 6, Second Edition, 6.5, A Superpower Adrift, into a Part 7, which itself is divided into three sections, namely the economy, the political scene, and general life and society in global age Japan. I have introduced a lot more statistics in Part 7, as I believe it is important in this global age to get a snapshot, as it were, of quantifiable data regarding social composition, population trends, and so forth. In particular, I have referred to a number of international indexes, such as those relating to quality of life, transparency of government, and so on. This gives us some idea of Japan's standing in the international community. On a personal note, I am flattered and delighted that my humble book on Japanese history is going into a third edition. It has also been translated into a wide range of languages, from Chinese to Estonian, though curiously there is not a Japanese translation that I am aware of, and has been recommended as a university text as well as for the general listener. I am grateful to the translators and for all the positive comments, which fortunately greatly outweigh the negative ones. Finally, I wish the Japanese nation a speedy recovery from the 11th of March 2011 disaster, though speedy will be measured in years, and I grieve with them for the loss of life, and the loss of homes and the treasured items that all form part of the lives of the survivors. It is hard to imagine the terror of such an event. Pictures are not enough. You have to experience it. Here in Christchurch, we have experienced two major devastating earthquakes, 4th September 2010 and 22nd February 2011, in less than 6 months, in the second of which my son barely escaped from a falling ceiling in a large building. To pass crushed corpses when seeking your son is not what any parent wants to do. And yet, such an experience is lightweight compared to the suffering in Japan. Ken Henshall, Christchurch, New Zealand, October 2011. Introduction. Japan and History. The impact Japan has had on the modern world is enormous. It occupies less than 1/300th of the planet's land area, yet at the height of its economic growth in the 1980s, it wielded 1/6th of the planet's economic might, and remains the third-ranking economy in the world. There will be few homes and offices that do not rely on at least some Japanese technology. Japanese cars rule the roads. Despite recent problems with so-called Japanese-style management, many Western and Asian managers still try to do things the Japanese way. Japanese foreign aid props up many a developing country's economy. Project developers around the world seek Japanese investment. Tourist operators target the large numbers of wealthy Japanese who now travel overseas. Japan itself features as one of the most popular of all places I would like to visit in Western surveys. The list goes on. A leading player on the world scene, Japan's absence from any major international forum would be unthinkable. No modern history of the world could fail to give it very considerable space. And yet, of all the nations on the planet, Japan has come closest to annihilation. It is the only nation ever to have suffered nuclear attack. Many among its enemies in the Second World War genuinely believed the extermination of the Japanese race was necessary for the safety of humankind. Even humanitarians like Franklin Roosevelt seemed to think ethnic cleansing might be beneficial all round. In the end, the Japanese survived. Far from being annihilated, Japan is one of the most powerful nations on Earth. Far from being forced into inter-ethnic breeding, the Japanese remain ethnically one of the most homogeneous of all populations. Japan's arrival in the world arena has been dramatic. From a quaint and obscure land of paddy fields and feudal despots just 150 years ago, it rapidly became a major contender among the imperialist powers, a military threat to the world order, and then, its crisis passed, an economic superpower. For many Westerners, exotic and patronizing 19th-century images of coolly hatted rice farmers, doll-like geisha, and funny little men trying to look civilized gave way to brutal warlords and fanatical samurai soldiers mindlessly loyal to an evil emperor. After the war, the images changed again to slave-like workers controlled by ruthless capitalists out to dominate the world, and who succeeded in doing so. For many Asians, especially Chinese and Koreans, the one-time land of dwarves ceased to be a backward pupil. The pupil became a harsh master, and a vicious and exploitative one at that. Though they respect Japan's inspirational economic achievements, many Asians have still not forgiven Japan for its pre-war and wartime behavior in their lands. Not all images have been negative. Among Westerners, at the start of the 20th century, Japan was respected for its military victories over China and Russia and was considered an ally by some powers. After its defeat in the Second World War, it was admired for the way it set about the task of rebuilding the nation. The economic miracle that soon followed was an object for analysis, and would-be imitators looked for the key to success in its educational system, its political organization, and particularly its management practices. Among Asians, alongside the wartime images of rape and pillage and murder, there is also a grudging recognition that Japan has at least put Asia on the map in terms of world respect, and overturned Western condescension. Many Asian nations have openly tried to model their economies on Japan's, despite a few pitfalls. Some, notably Malaysia, have positively sung its praises. Even though Japan at the turn of the millennium fell from grace, a little as a result of its economic recession and holes in its management practices, it is still clear that the current prevailing image of Japan and its impact on the world is largely economic in nature, though in recent years it can also claim to be a technological and cultural superpower. In fact, Japan's focus on economic growth at the expense of quality of life and other matters has been one of the major criticisms leveled at it. At least an image of economic obsession is better than one of military fanaticism. To understand the makings of an economic superpower, it is not enough just to examine its economic development. Certainly, this is important and is dealt with in some detail in this book. However, Japan's post-war drive to achieve economic supremacy cannot be separated from its pre-war drive to achieve military supremacy, nor from its 19th-century drive to modernize and become a world imperialist power, nor even from its grand ambitions of the 7th century to be taken seriously as a civilized nation. It is vital to consider the historical progress of the nation in broad terms. The progression through history of any nation owes much to chance and circumstance. In Japan's case, it was largely a matter of luck that the ancient Chinese and Koreans did not take Japan seriously enough to make a concerted effort to occupy it, or that the Mongols did not do a better job of their botched invasions in the 13th century. The Japanese were fortunate again that in the 16th century, the European powers of the day were more interested in exploiting the New World than Japan, thanks to a chance discovery by Columbus. Similarly, Western powers of the 19th century were more interested in carving up China than bothering about Japan. And if America had decided to be more punitive and less constructive after the war, Japan would have been powerless to prevent it. At any of these turning points, fortune could have turned against Japan instead of for it, and produced a different history. But a nation's historical development also owes much to the way in which it responds to circumstance, how it makes the most of opportunities and, in a sense, makes its own luck. These patterns of response, at least in Japan's case, are based on values and practices that often have deep roots in its history. It is impossible to understand fully Japan's emergence as a modern superpower without some understanding of these. It is important to start at the beginning, tracing Japan's development and noting these continuities as they emerge and recur. Along the way lie a number of probable surprises. For example, Japan has the oldest pottery vessels yet discovered anywhere in the world. On the other hand, despite its association with rice, it was the latest of all Asian nations to cultivate it. The medieval samurai was typically quite unlike his modern idealized image of a loyal warrior who fought to the death for his lord. In the 18th century, Japan had the world's largest city and the world's most literate population. In the 19th century, Japan was not just following the West, as popularly believed, but busily resurrecting practices from its ancient past. In the 20th century, Pearl Harbor was not the first Japanese strike in the Pacific War, nor was America the first Western victim. Moreover, America had plans to strike Japan first, and for all his massive impact during the occupation, it was not really MacArthur who designed post-war Japan, but little-known planners in Washington's State Department, particularly Hugh Borton. There are also mysteries and controversies. Who exactly were the Yayoi invaders of more than 2,000 years ago? Where did they come from? How many came? Why did they come? Who was the mysterious Queen Himiko of the 3rd century? And where was her realm of Yamatai located? Was it the same as the later Yamato, from which modern-day Japan derives? Why did the Japanese furiously adopt firearms after they were introduced by the Portuguese in the 16th century, but not bother to do so when the Mongols introduced them 3 centuries earlier? In more recent times, just how much of a surprise was Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor? How close was Japan to developing its own atom bomb? How guilty was Hirohito? Japan's history is many things. It is an adventure story, fascinating even just as a simple chronicle of events. It is a mystery story, with intriguing questions yet to be fully answered. And it is a textbook, with many lessons, both do's and don'ts, for the Japanese themselves and for the world at large. Part 1. From the Stone Age to Statehood. Myths, Prehistory, and Ancient History, 2710. 1.1. Making Gods of Emperors. Ancient History According to Japan's Myths. In Takamagahara, the plain of high heaven, a number of deities have come into existence. Below lies a swirling mass of liquid. Two of the deities, Izanagi, he who invites, and Izanami, she who invites, are sent to turn this liquid into land. Izanagi dips his spear into the liquid, and the drops that fall coagulate into the island of Onogoro, self-curdling island. The two deities descend to populate it. Numerous divine offspring are produced, not only by vaginal birth, but from other bodily parts and even from bodily waste. The god of fire, alas, is one deity born vaginally, and Izanami is burned to death as she gives birth. Her distraught husband Izanagi travels to Yomi, the land of the dead, to try to bring her back to the land of the living. However, she is shamed and angered when he sees her maggot-riddled body, and she chases him out of Yomi. As he bathes himself in a river to wash away the pollution of death, deities emerge from his clothes and eyes and nose. They include the sun goddess Amaterasu, light of heaven, and the storm and sea god Susanoo, wild male. Izanagi sends Amaterasu to Takamagahara to rule over the heavens, while Susanoo is given the sea to rule. The wayward Susanoo, however, disobeys his father, who banishes him. Before heading into exile, Susanoo visits his sister Amaterasu in Takamagahara. At his suggestion, they produce a number of children, but quarrel over his motives. Susanoo then torments his sister. He destroys the ridges between her rice paddies, smears excrement on the walls of her palace, and throws a flayed pony through the roof of her weaving shed. Amaterasu retreats into a cave, plunging the universe into darkness. The other deities try to lure her back out. They hang a mirror and jeweled necklace in a tree. One goddess then performs a lewd dance, exposing herself and making all the other deities laugh uproariously. Intrigued by the laughter, Amaterasu peeps out from the cave, sees the jewels and mirror, and comes out to inspect them. The deities seize her and block up the entrance to the cave with a boulder. Susanoo has his banishment enforced. He goes to Izumo, Shimane Prefecture, where he has various adventures. On one occasion he slays a monster that has been devouring children. In one of its 8 tails he finds a sword, which he later presents to his sister Amaterasu as a token of remorse. The sword, mirror, and jewels still form the imperial regalia of Japan. Susanoo's son, Okuninushi, is credited with pacifying the wild land. A hero, he becomes the victim of numerous treacherous acts by his jealous brothers, and even by his father, Susanoo. They murder him several times, but he is restored to life each time. Okuninushi's sons agree to a request from Amaterasu to let her descendants rule the land. Her great-great-grandson, Jimmu, becomes the first ruler of Japan. Japan's ancient myths were first recorded in the late 7th century, eventually appearing as the Kojiki, Record of Ancient Things, in 712, and the Nihongi, or Nihon Shoki, Chronicle, or Chronicles of Japan, in 720. They were initiated by Emperor Temu, reigned 673-86, who wanted to legitimize the supremacy of the imperial family by giving it divine origins. Given this aim, it is curious that no real distinction is made between deity and mortal, either behaviorally, morally, or in terms of creation. Apart from a few unexplained references to mysterious aboriginals, the people of the myths seem to be earthborn descendants of gods or demigods, meaning that almost all Japanese could claim divine descent. At least the imperial family could claim descent from the supreme deity, Amaterasu, and not the fallen deity Susanoo. The chronicles are obviously unreliable as records of historical fact. Nevertheless, to the cautious observer, they still provide a valuable means of understanding Japan's ancient past. In broad terms, they reveal a clash between the imperial family, represented by Amaterasu's line, and a rival family based in Izumo, represented by Susanoo's line, which ended with the supremacy of the imperial family being agreed to. This is almost certainly a reflection of real events. However, the political slant of the accounts plays down the importance of Izumo. A dramatic hint of its actual threat as a rival power base was revealed in 1984 with the discovery there of a cache of 358 bronze swords dating back around 2,000 years. This was more than the total number of ancient swords found anywhere else in Japan. The unusual and specific nature of many of the events in the myths, such as the incident with the flayed pony, also strongly suggests actual persons and occurrences. Such incidents provide an interesting commentary on life in ancient Japan, a world of violence and sudden death, a world where brutality and raw emotion prevail over finer feelings, and where parents kill or abandon their children and brother slays brother. Cruelty seems to have been commonplace. On one occasion, Okuninushi's brothers split open a tree, keep it open with a wedge, force him into the opening, and then remove the wedge, crushing him to death. Out of sheer malice, the same brothers also trick a live-skinned rabbit into bathing in salt water and then lying in the wind, to suffer torment when its body blisters. Another episode describes a prince killing his elder brother, in the sneakiest of ways, when his victim is in the toilet, and then pulling off his limbs and throwing them away. Such cruel acts are not unknown in myths and early histories elsewhere in the world, but what is quite distinctive about the Japanese myths is an avoidance of moral judgment as to good or evil. Certain acts bring censure and punishment, but no moral sermonizing. For example, Susanoo is simply removed as disruptive rather than condemned as evil. Gods and their earthborn descendants are as good and as bad as each other. Behavior is accepted or rejected depending on the situation, not according to any obvious set of universal principles. This is exactly what many commentators remark upon in present-day Japanese behavior. The roots of such behavior clearly run deep. 1.2. the earliest inhabitants, to circa 13,000 BC. No one is quite sure when the first humans appeared in Japan. Claims have been made for a date as far back as 500,000 years, and some even expect a history of a million years to be proven in due course. The general agreement at present allows for around 200,000 years, though the earliest definite human fossil remains are only about 30,000 years old. Until the end of the last glacial period, around 13,000 years ago, Japan was joined to the Asian mainland by a number of land bridges. These were through Sakhalin to the north, Tsushima to the west, and the Ryukyu Islands to the south. In other words, migration into the area was not difficult. Immigrants arrived in waves, particularly from East and Southeast Asia some 30,000 years ago, followed by people from Northeast Asia about 14,000 years ago. It is hard to paint a picture of Paleolithic, Old Stone Age, life with any certainty. One major difficulty is that much of the coastline of that time is now deep underwater. There may have been far more coastal activity than the surviving inland sites suggest. The picture emerging so far is basically one of small and seasonally mobile groups of hunter-gatherers. The hunters targeted not only boar and deer, but also big game such as elephant and bison, though these were becoming scarcer in the last Paleolithic phase owing to climatic warming and increased hunting by a growing population. Gatherers searched for a variety of berries and nuts, such as hazel. Paleolithic groups were made up of a small number of extended families and totaled between 20 and 150 individuals. Extended families were important for the rearing of children, since many parents were dead before their 30s, and there were many orphaned children needing the protection of the longer-lived among the adults. Although the population was growing, it probably never exceeded 20,000. As nomadic hunter-gatherers, most groups had only temporary, seasonal bases. However, there was some, though limited, stable settlement towards the end of the period. There was also a degree of specialization, which led to trading. As early as 20,000 years ago, obsidian, volcanic glass valued for tool-making, was traded over at least 150 kilometers. This was almost certainly carried by water, indicating that watercraft were in use from very early times. Stone Age people are popularly portrayed as cave dwellers. However, at least in the case of Japan, caves seem only rarely to have been used as sites of significant permanent occupation, though quite a large number of caves were used as temporary shelters. The preference for open space sites suggests the wide use of artificial shelter, though the nature of this is unclear. Important Paleolithic sites include Babadan and Takamori in Miyagi Prefecture, Hoshino in Tochigi Prefecture, Fukui Cave in Nagasaki Prefecture, Nogawa near Chofu in Tokyo Prefecture, Iwajuku in Gunma Prefecture, and Minatogawa in Okinawa. Judging by a 155-centimeter male skeleton excavated at Minatogawa and estimated to be around 17,000 years old, Paleolithic people in Japan appear to have been small by modern standards, but similar to other Paleolithic peoples elsewhere in East Asia. Knowledge of Japan's prehistoric past was hampered till after the Second World War by the tendency of Japanese archaeologists to interpret their finds in line with the pseudo-historical accounts in early chronicles such as the Kojiki and Nihon Shoki. Knowledge of the period is now increasing, but much still remains to be discovered. It is still not even clear whether the first inhabitants were Homo sapiens or the earlier Homo erectus. 1.3. Stone Age Hunters and Gatherers, the Jomon Period, circa 13,000 BC to circa 400 BC. Around 13,000 BC, pottery vessels appeared in Japan. They are the oldest in the world. They also mark the beginning of the Jomon Period, named after the Jomon cord pattern, found impressed on much of that pottery. Pottery vessels might suggest a settled lifestyle. Settlement did not increase during the period, especially from around 5000 BC. Groups also expanded into larger tribal communities. The largest Jomon village yet discovered, at Senai Maruyama in Aomori Prefecture, thrived for about 1,500 years, between 3500 BC and 2000 BC. It covered almost 100 acres and may have had as many as 500 inhabitants at its peak. It is even seen by some as suggesting that Japan could have been a cradle of early civilization. Settlement is also associated with agriculture. Primitive slash-and-burn agriculture may have been practiced in the west of the country as early as 5700 BC. The remains of what appears to be a prehistoric farming community were unearthed in 1997 at Bibi in Hokkaido, dating back to around 4000 BC. This is the oldest evidence of real farming in Japan. Rice was introduced into the southwest of the country from the continent towards the end of the period, around 1000 BC, along with millet and barley, but was not widely grown. When it was in dry fields or marshes rather than paddies. Prior to these introduced plants, the most important cultivated plants were probably the beefsteak herb and barnyard grass. However, despite the pottery and the occasional evidence of farming, the life of the Jomon people was for the most part one of hunting and gathering, particularly on the coast. Settlements were typically of a semi-permanent nature, in the form of a base camp in a given area, and had around a dozen dwellings. These dwellings were usually pit houses with thatched roofs reaching down to the ground. Inland Jomon people, using the bow and arrow that appeared around the same time as pottery, mostly hunted boar and deer. At times they also ate a variety of creatures, from frogs to badgers to wolves to the Siberian lion. In fact, seemingly the entire range of Japan's rich fauna. The dog was the only domesticated animal during the period. Many, if not most, Jomon people dwelled on the coast and became particularly adept at using marine resources, from shellfish to oceanic fish. So well did they adapt to this life that Jomon skeletons, particularly of the latter half of the period, showed development of bony protection for the ear mechanisms, strongly suggesting regular and frequent diving. The reason for this coastal preference was that the warming of the climate around 13,000 years ago, which cut off the land bridges, also meant a warming of the seas and an increase in marine resources. Shellfish, in particular, became a major food source for thousands of years, as evidenced by huge shell mounds such as at Natsushima near Tokyo Bay. The climate started to cool again around 5,000 years ago, and sea levels receded. Greater use was then made of inland resources. However, many Jomon people returned to the coast within 1,000 years or so, despite the still cooling climate. This suggests that their preference for the life of coastal foragers and fishers was persistent. The introduction of rice around 3,000 years ago was probably from China through Korea, where rice cultivation slightly predates that in Japan, though opinion is divided as to the route. Many present-day Japanese make much of the nation's association with rice and assume it has been grown there from time immemorial. But in fact, Japan was the last of the Asian nations to adopt rice cultivation. It can be misleading to think of the Jomon period as a single fixed entity, for it contains significant variety, both in terms of region and time. Regional variety clearly reflected local conditions, producing, for example, subcultures such as that centered on deep-sea fishing on the northeast coast. Variety over time reflected not only the warming and cooling of the climate, but the development of new technology. For example, hemp cloth was produced from around 5000 BC, and lacquerware from around 4000 BC. The population also seems to have varied over time, often for reasons that are not clear. Though estimates vary and are really only best guesses, it was probably around 20,000 at the start of the period, rose to around 100,000 by about 5,000 BC, leapt up to more than twice that by around 3,000 BC, despite the cooling of the climate, then fell back again to about 100,000 by the end of the period. Moreover, again for reasons that are unclear, by this stage the population was gathered largely in the north and northeast. Other broad changes over time include a progressive increase in awareness of the supernatural. This brought increased shamanism and ritualism, New burial practices, mysterious stone circles in northern Japan, and figurines that seem to have a supernatural significance. Representations of snakes in some locations suggest snake worship. The increased importance of religious ritual brought about a need for specialized knowledge of procedure. This, in turn, would have helped lead to differentiation in levels of status within society. Tribal chiefs, too, along with the more capable hunters and producers, obviously enjoyed a higher status than most. However, it remains a contested issue as to whether Juman society was mainly hierarchical or egalitarian. It is highly likely that over such a long span of time as the Juman period, sundry groups would have migrated into Japan from various points, adding a certain degree of ethnic diversity. The disappearance of the land bridges would not have meant a total severing of links with the mainland. Somebody, for example, introduced rice. The number of these immigrants is open to question, but they were perhaps not very numerous, or at least not very different physically, for there seems to have been a recognizable Juman type. Juman people as a whole are invariably described as short-statured. There are confusing differences in the heights given by experts, but in general, Juman males towards the end of the period seem to have been around 157 centimeters, and females 148 centimeters. These heights contrast with those of the subsequent Yayoi immigrants, who arrived around 400 BC and marked a new era. The Yayoi were some 3 or 4 centimeters taller and little different from their modern Japanese descendants at the start of the 20th century. As well as being relatively short in stature, the Juman people typically had a stocky, muscular appearance. They had heavy skeletons, flattened leg bones, and wide, square faces. In fact, the Juman people bore considerable similarity to the present-day Ainu of Hokkaido. This is not surprising, for studies by physical anthropologists confirm that the Ainu are unmistakably descended from Juman people. This sets them apart from modern Japanese in the other main islands, who overall show greater descent from the Yayoi, though this is a matter of degree, since 43% of males in Japan carry a Y chromosome related to Juman genes, ranging from 25% in southern regions to 60% in the north. It is unclear when exactly they arrived in the country, or even exactly where from, but Ainu certainly have a very great antiquity as inhabitants of Japan. The Ainu are in effect the original Japanese. For many centuries, the Yayoi derived modern Japanese, known in this context as Yamato Japanese, were to deny this, and to marginalize or even ignore the Ainu. Though there was semi-official recognition of the indigenous status of the Ainu during the 1990s, it was not until 6th of June 2008 that there was full and formal legal recognition of them as such. We see in the Ainu the Juman origins of Japan, but Juman Japan was still far from being a nation. The following Yayoi period was to contribute far more to the emergence of Japan as we know it today. 1.4. New Beginnings, the Yayoi period, circa 400 BC to circa AD 250. Around 400 BC, or possibly even as early as 1000 BC, according to some scholars, Japan was effectively invaded. Immigrants arrived in number from the continent, immigrants different in appearance and culture from the Juman people. They were lighter and taller, with narrower faces. Their culture included technology such as bronze and iron, and was also more rice-based than that in Japan. There is great diversity of opinion over the nature and scale of this immigration, and even the motives and origins of the immigrants. The picture is confused, but what is clear is that newcomers arrived, very probably in northwest Kyushu initially, and were to change Juman Japan forever. Genetically, in modern Japan, 54% of male lines and 66% of female lines show Sino-Korean origins, reflecting this influx. In material terms, both Korean and Chinese artifacts are found at this time. The period when this change started takes its name from the Yayoi district in Tokyo, where in 1884 a new plain reddish type of pottery was first found and recognized as different from Juman. The name does not convey the dynamism of the period, for at the time this was not realized. The period has always been strongly associated with rice. At first it was thought that rice had been brought by the new immigrants, but this is now known to be an oversimplification. Rice had been introduced earlier. However, it was during the Yayoi period that rice cultivation first became established on any significant scale, particularly in paddies and particularly in the south and west of the country. And this clearly reflected the cultural preferences of the newcomers. It was to become a cultural foundation for subsequent Japanese through to the present. The spread of rice cultivation, like the spread of bronze and iron, reflected the probable movement of the immigrants. From the southwest, it moved fairly quickly to the middle of Honshu, before the start of the 1st century AD, but was slower to extend further north. Although rice, bronze, and iron were present here from an early stage, they were not adopted on any significant scale, and northern Japan was effectively to remain in a continuing Jomon phase till around the 8th century or even later. In other words, there was a substantial cultural gap between north and south, one still symbolized today by the Ainu presence in Hokkaido. Japan has limited metal ore of its own, so metal implements tended to be associated with high status. However, the possession of metal status goods was not the only factor in the increasing social stratification that forms a major characteristic of the period. As with most agricultural development, rice cultivation brought about a narrowing of the resource base within a community, making it easier for it to be controlled by social elites. It also brought about far more permanent settlement, giving rise to greater territorial identification and, particularly as the population grew to around 2 million, the need to defend and expand boundaries. This led in turn to increased fighting, in which those who possessed metal weapons, in addition to the ability to muster warrior forces, had their status further strengthened. And of course, increasing warfare between tribes led to intertribal ranking in terms of winners and losers. In this increasingly ranked world, slavery was not uncommon. Lower-ranking persons who met a superior on the road stepped aside and bowed as the superior passed, a practice that continued right through to the 19th century. Rank was differentiated by a range of titles, and men of high status had 4 or 5 wives, as opposed to the 2 or 3 wives of lower-ranking men. Another factor adding to the stratification was wealth, particularly as a result of trade. Some tribes were lucky enough to have some of Japan's scant metal resources in their own territory. Others benefited from new technological developments, such as that of silk, which was produced in Kyushu from around the 1st century AD. There were also developments in glass technology and metallurgy. This increased diversity of products led to increased trade, both with the continent and within Japan, and each district had a marketplace. One such exchange center, Asahi, in Aichi Prefecture, is the largest Yayoi settlement yet found, covering almost 200 acres as opposed to the 5 to 70 acres of the typical settlement. The combination of intertribal warfare, the emergence of elites, and competition for control of resources led to increasing politicization. Many chiefdoms entered into strategic tribal allegiances with neighbors, leading to the formation of numerous small kingdoms. Much of our knowledge of these kingdoms, as indeed of life in general in Yayoi Japan, is gleaned from Chinese documents. The first written mention of the country is found in the Han Shu, History of Han, a Chinese history completed around AD 82. It referred to the land of Hua, then meaning the land of dwarves, as comprising 100 kingdoms, whose envoys regularly brought tribute to the Chinese base at Lolang in Korea. A far more detailed description is given in the Wei Qi, History of Wei, one of the 3 kingdoms of China at the time of AD 297, in a section on Eastern barbarians that also includes various peoples of Korea and Manchuria. The Wei Qi recounts a visit to Hua in 240 by Wei Chinese. In particular, it describes the strongest of the 100 kingdoms, Shimatai, usually rendered in Japanese as Yamatai. Yamatai was ruled by an unmarried shaman queen called Himiko. She was a rather mysterious figure who achieved power after many years of warfare and occupied herself with magic and sorcery, bewitching the people. Living permanently within a fortress, she was guarded by 100 men and served by 1,000 women and a single male attendant. It was through this male attendant that she communicated with the outside world. She concerned herself with spiritual matters and left the administrative aspects of ruling to her younger brother. In 238, Himiko sent a tributary delegation to the Chinese emperor, following a practice observed since at least AD 57 by some of the rulers of other kingdoms in Hua. As a result, like those other rulers, she had her regal status officially recognized by China. However, unlike the others, she seems to have been recognized as sovereign of the whole land of Hua, not just of a kingdom within it. She also received gifts from the emperor of various cloths, jewels, and mirrors. Her own gifts to him included slaves, cloths, and cinnabar. According to the Chinese historians, she died in 248 at the age of 65, accompanied by 100 sacrificed slaves. Chaos followed her death, till a 13-year-old girl named Io, a relative of Himiko, eventually came to the throne after the abortive accession of a male ruler whom the people refused to obey. Yamatai was the center of power in Japan, with many, if not most, other kingdoms giving allegiance to it. It has also long been the center of controversy as to its location, for surprisingly, this is not clear. The description of the journey in the Wei Qi is open to very different interpretations. Most experts equate Yamatai with Yamato, in the Nara Basin area, which was to be the site of the first Japanese state a few hundred years later, but others see it as located in North Kyushu. The descriptions of Hua, Japan, found in the Wei Qi and other Chinese documents represent a significant distinction between the Yayoi period and earlier periods, a shift from prehistory to recorded history. The period itself was an intense and even revolutionary one of great change over a relatively short span of time. It witnessed a leap from hunting and gathering to cultivation, and from stone tools to metal tools. Settlements became fixed, and society became clearly stratified. These changes created the economic and technological base for a social and political unification into a state. 1.5. The early state emerges, the Kofun Yamato period, circa 250 to 710. When Queen Himiko was buried with her 100 slaves, it was obvious that a large tomb was needed, 100 paces in diameter, according to the Wei Qi. This was to set the fashion for some centuries, as society became more stratified. Those at the top wanted to show their status beyond the span of their mere mortal life. As with the pyramids in ancient Egypt, huge tombs were erected. In Japan's case, they were usually raised mounds, kofun, surrounded by hollow clay figurines known as haniwa, clay rings. The haniwa are rather mysterious, but seem to have been a combination of tomb markers and status objects. There were also objects inside the tomb, probably for the afterlife. Many of these, too, were status objects, but it was not all a case of mere ostentation. The tombs also contained large numbers of weapons, leaving no doubt as to the ability of the ruling elite to maintain their position by force if necessary. The burial mounds are convenient physical symbols of this period. The most important feature of the era, however, is the emergence of the Yamato state, named after its power base at Yamato in the Nara Basin. The preeminence of Yamato forms the substance of the Kujiki and Nihon Shoki accounts. We saw earlier that these do not reveal much about the actual process, other than a triumph over a rival power base at Izumo by what appears to have been negotiation. Dates are also unreliable. Most experts now believe the first verifiable emperor was Su Jin. The Nihon Shoki lists him as the 10th emperor and gives his death as equivalent to 30 BC, whereas the Kojiki gives it as AD 258. In fact, 318 seems most likely. Some believe that Su Jin may have been the leader of a group of 4th-century invaders from Korea known as the Horse Riders, and that it was these horse riders who established the Yamato state. The scenario of ancient Japan coming under at least the partial authority of people from Korea is not at all impossible. For even if Su Jin himself was not a Korean, and even if there was no actual conquest by horse riders coming from or through the Korean peninsula, there was certainly a strong and generally amicable link between ancient Yamato Japan and the Korean kingdoms of Pakche, Bakche, and Koguryo, Goguryo, including among the aristocratic classes and indeed the ruling class, for example the Soga family and Prince Shotoku, discussed presently. Whether founded by Koreans or Japanese, or a combination of both, the Yamato clan increased their power and authority by a gradual process of degree. In this they relied heavily on negotiation and persuasion, and no doubt threat and coercion, rather than simple military confrontation. Their preferred method seems to have been to incorporate local chiefdoms, already established in Yayoi times, and give the chieftains themselves places within the Yamato hierarchy. Ranks and titles were used by the Yamato court to give potentially troublesome members of formerly independent local regimes a personal stake in the emerging imperial system. The tactic of, where possible, incorporating a powerful threat rather than directly confronting it, and of drawing on a potential opponent's strengths rather than trying simply to destroy them, is still widely seen today as a basic Japanese preference. Its identification at such an early stage of Japanese history is testimony to the depth of such a tradition. The ranks and titles given to those local kings and chiefs incorporated into the Yamato camp were important in a status-conscious age. The Yamato administrative system was strongly hierarchical. This, too, is a continuing characteristic of Japanese preferences. Exact dates remain unclear. It is probable that during the 4th and 5th centuries Yamato authority was not absolute, but rather first among equals, among a coalition of clans. By the early 6th century, however, the Yamato imperial family seems to have emerged as the single prevailing line. It was at this point that rulers of the Izumo region started to send tribute to the Yamato ruler. A sense of statehood is also suggested in a poem attributed to the late 5th century Emperor Yuriaku, reigned 456-79. Your basket, with your pretty basket, your trowel with your pretty trowel. Maiden, picking herbs on this hillside, I would ask you, where is your home? Will you not tell me your name? Over the spacious land of Yamato, it is I who reign so wide and far. It is I who rule so wide and far. I myself, as your lord, will tell you of my home and my name. The Yamato state soon entrenched its position by the adoption and promotion of Buddhism. This was especially favored by the Soga, a particularly powerful clan within the Yamato structure. The Soga were of Korean descent, like many of the aristocratic families of the day, and probably felt more of an affinity with Buddhism than did native Japanese. It was from Korea, specifically priest scholars from the Korean kingdom of Pakche, that Buddhism was introduced in the mid-6th century. Its adoption was greatly aided by the practice of writing, which had also been introduced by scholars from Pakche a century earlier. The Soga saw Buddhism as a means of developing a state religion that would further their political control, which by means such as intermarriage, they were starting to assert over the imperial family. They were undoubtedly a persuasive element in the acceptance of the religion by the imperial family from Emperor Yomei, reigned 585-7. For its part, the imperial line also saw Buddhism as politically very useful. It provided a unifying ideology for the new nation. Its identification with the imperial family also meant that the spread of Buddhism helped spread acceptance of imperial authority. Moreover, and very importantly, it conferred a degree of Chinese-style dignity and civilization on the newly emerging state. Japan did very much want to be taken seriously. This was not just as a deterrent against possible further invasion. It was a genuine wish to achieve the best, to become a strong nation. To this end, it was soon to adopt a range of Chinese practices, till eventually it could feel it had outdone China and had nothing left to learn. Here again, we see an early example of the incorporation of the strengths of others, combined with a willingness to learn and emulate. During much of Japan's Kofun period, China was not at its strongest. In fact, it was in considerable turmoil, with a multiplicity of changing power bases and dynasties between the end of the late Han period in 220 and the start of the Tang in 618. For some of this time, the country was divided into three kingdoms of Wei, Wu, and Shu Han. The Korean Peninsula, which was generally the closest point of foreign contact for Japan, was also characterized by the coexistence of three major kingdoms between 300 and 668. These were Pakche and Silla, in the south, and Koguryo, from which the modern name Korea derives, in the north. Wedged between Silla and Pakche, there was also a small area called Kaya, Memana in Japanese, which was a confederation of some half-dozen chiefdoms or minor kingdoms. The Nihon Shoki treats Kaya as a Japanese colony, but this is unlikely. So, too, is the claimed invasion of Silla by the legendary Empress Jingu, a 4th-century shaman ruler. Many aspects of Japan's relations with these Korean kingdoms are unclear, but its relations with both Kaya and Pakche were generally strong and beneficial. Japan benefited not only from the introduction of writing and Buddhism, but also from access to valuable sources of iron ore. Its relations with Silla were not so good, and as Silla rose to dominance on the Korean peninsula from the mid-6th century, Japan's involvement there waned. A century or so later, the very survival of Pakche was under threat, and in 663 the Pakche rulers requested assistance from Yamato Japan against attack from a combined force from Silla and Tang China. Japan responded promptly and sent a large fleet of some 800 ships, but despite numerical supremacy, was badly defeated at the mouth of the Gum River in what is known as the Battle of Bakgang, through a combination of poor tactics and poor vessels, the latter quite surprising for an island nation. Silla then went on to establish control over the Korean Peninsula, bringing the period of the Three Kingdoms to an end a few years later. Fortunately for the new Yamato rulers, Silla does not seem to have been interested in following up its victory by attempting to invade Japan, though the Japanese did take the precaution of building a fortified defense base in North Kyushu, known as the Dazaifu, which was to become an important center over the next few centuries. Japan's emulation of China was particularly seen in the activities of Yomei's second son, Prince Shotoku, Shotoku Taishi, 574-622, who was half Soga by blood, probably the best-known figure of those times. From 594 till his death in 622, Shotoku was regent under Empress Suiko, reigned 593-628. He greatly contributed not only to the promotion of Buddhism by the building of numerous temples, but to the promotion of all things Chinese. Among other things, he was responsible for re-establishing missions to a now reunified China, and for introducing the Chinese-style cap-rank system, in which, as the name suggests, the rank of officials was indicated by their hat. Shotoku is also credited with drawing up the so-called 17-article constitution of 604, which was intended to strengthen central government. It had a strong Chinese flavor, particularly in its Confucianism. Though deemed a constitution, it was, however, largely a set of guidelines for officials, with a particular emphasis on harmony, wa, and loyalty to the divine and therefore legitimate authority of the imperial line. Something of its nature can be seen from the opening words of Article 1, which quote Confucius and state that harmony is to be valued, and from the opening words of Article 8, which are of a less grand and more specific character, let the ministers and functionaries attend the court early in the morning and retire late. The Soga clan was the major influence in the early Yamato court, often controlling the imperial line itself. However, In 645, it was overthrown in a coup led by Fujiwara no Kamatari, 614 to 99. The Fujiwara were to dominate court life in Japan for some centuries to come, but they did not change the Soga clan's promotion of things Chinese. Along with the future Emperor Tenji, reigned 661 to 71, Kamatari put in place a number of ambitious reforms based on the Chinese model of central government. These reforms are known collectively as the Taika, Great Change, reforms of 645. One major reform was the nationalization of land. Paddies were henceforth to be allocated by the government. Every 6 years, all free adult males received approximately 0.3 acres, and females 0.2 acres. Other reforms included taxation in the form of produce and not simply labor, a restructuring of ranks, and, in contrast to the previous practice of shifting capitals, the establishment of a permanent capital at Naniwa, present-day Osaka, though in practice this did not remain the capital for more than a few years. Moreover, orders were given for the surveying and registering of land and population. Taxation practices and claimed ranks of various local officials were investigated with a view to eliminating corruption. Unauthorized weapons were confiscated. Chinese-style law codes were drawn up in connection with these reforms. They emphasized the authority of the emperor and thus the centralization of power, and they also addressed the rationalization of bureaucracy. These various laws are known generically as Ritsuryo, Ritsu being essentially penal sanctions and Ryo being instructions for officials. Though not always carried out as intended, Ritsuryo law during the 8th century permitted a small group of around 400 officials to control a country of about 5 million people. The population had grown markedly through the Yamato period from the estimated 2 to 3 million at the end of the Yayoi period. Though small, relative to China's population of more than 60 million, the 5 million or so people in Japan at the end of the 7th century represented a huge figure compared to European populations of the time. Population growth seems to have progressed in waves. The birth rate was high, but so too was the mortality rate, especially among infants. A major factor in this was the waves of epidemic disease such as smallpox transmitted through extensive contact with the continent, against which the insular Japanese had developed little or no immunity. Some idea of the helplessness of people in the face of the ravages of these diseases is seen in the poetry of Yamanui Yokura, circa 660 to 733. An official eventually elevated to the rank of minor aristocrat, but of humble origin, Okura was one of the few poets before modern times to write of everyday life, including subjects shunned by other poets such as illness and poverty. Moreover, he was a true family man, one of the few manager officials ever recorded in Japan's history to leave a function early and openly in order to spend time with his family. He is thus a valuable source of information on real life around this point in history. He writes as follows on the death of his young son, Furuhi. The seven treasures prized by man in this world, what are they to me? Furuhi, the dear white pearl that was born to us, with dawn would not leave our bed, but standing or lying, played and romped with us. With the evening star, linking hands with us, he would say, "Come to bed, father and mother. Let me sleep between you, like sweet Daphne, triple-stocked." Such were his pretty words. For good or ill, we should see him grow to manhood, or so we trusted, as in a great ship. Then, beyond all thought, blowing hard, a sudden crosswind of illness overwhelmed him. Lacking skill and knowing no cure, with white hemp I tied my sleeves, took my mirror in my hand, and, lifting up my eyes to the gods in heaven, I prayed. My brow laid on the ground. I did reverence to the gods of the earth. Be he ill or be he well, it is in your power, O gods. Thus I clamored in my prayers, yet no good came of it, for he wasted away. Each dawn spoke less, till his life was ended. I stood, I jumped, I stamped, I shrieked. I lay on the ground, I beat my breast and wailed. Yet the child I held so tight has flown beyond my clasp. Is this the way of the world? Though life for the ordinary person was far from easy, the Yamato state was in place, and the nation, Japan, had been formed. State-level societies are generally characterized by effective unification, by social...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.